Have you ever followed the advice of one of your friends or family members, but it turned out to be bad advice? And then you had to work really hard to fix the mistake that you made? That's what happens to a girl in this Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. Welcome to Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. I'm so glad you could be here. Today we'll be reading East of the Sun and West of the Moon, illustrated by P.J. Lynch. It's a fairy tale from Norway that was first written down in 1844. Here's our title page. East of the Sun and West of the Moon, illustrated by P.J. Lynch. The story was translated from Norwegian into English back in 1859 by Sir George Webbe Dasent. Once on a time, there was a poor farmer who had so many children that he hadn't much of either food or clothing to give them. Pretty children they all were, but the prettiest was the youngest daughter, who was so lovely there was no end to her loveliness. Well, one day, 'twas on a Thursday evening late at the fall of the year, the weather was so wild and rough outside that the walls of the cottage shook. It was cruelly dark, and the rain fell, and the wind blew. There they all sat around the fire, busy with this thing and that, when all at once, something gave three taps on the window pane. Then the father went out to see what was the matter, and when he got out of doors, what should he see but a big white bear?
"Good evening to you,"
said the white bear.
"The same to you," said the man.
"Will you give me your youngest daughter? If you will, I'll make you as rich as you are now poor," said the bear.
Well, the man would not be at all sorry to be so rich. But still he thought he must have a talk with his daughter first. So he went in and told them how there was a great white bear waiting outside who had given his word to make them rich if he could only have the youngest daughter. The lassie said no, outright. Nothing could get her to say anything else. So the man went out and settled it with the white bear that he should come again the next Thursday evening and get an answer. In the meantime, he talked to his daughter of all the riches they would get, and how well off she would be herself. And so at last, she thought better of it, and washed and mended her rags, made herself as beautiful as she could, and was ready to start. I can't say her packing gave her much trouble. Next Thursday evening came the white bear to fetch her, and she got upon his back with her bundle, and off they went. When they had gone part of the way, the white bear said,
"Are you afraid?"
No, she wasn't.
"Well, mind hold tight to my shaggy coat, and then there's nothing to fear," said the bear.
So she rode a long, long way, till they came to a great steep hill. There, on the face of it, the white bear gave a knock, and a door opened, and they came into a castle, where there were many rooms all lit up, rooms gleaming with silver and gold. And there, too, was a table ready laid, and it was all as grand could be. Then the white bear gave her a silver bell, and when she wanted anything, she had only to ring it, and she would get it at once. Well, after she had eaten and drunk and evening wore on, she got sleepy after her journey and thought she would like to go to bed. So she rang the bell, and she had scarce taken hold of it before she found herself in a chamber where there was a bed made as fair and white as anyone would wish to sleep in, with silken pillows and curtains fringed with gold. All that was in the room was gold or silver. But when she had gone to bed and put out the light, a man came and laid himself alongside her. That was the white bear who threw off his beast shape at night. But she never saw him as a man, for he always came after she had put out the light, and before the day dawned, he was up and off again. So things went on happily for a while. But at last she began to get silent and sorrowful, for she longed to go home and see her father and mother and brothers and sisters. So one day when the white bear asked what it was that she lacked, she said it was so dull and lonely there, and she longed to go home and see her father and mother and brothers and sisters. And that was why she was so sad and sorrowful, because she couldn't get to them.
"Well, well," said the bear, "perhaps there's a cure for all this. But you must promise me one thing, not to talk alone with your mother, but only when the rest are by to hear. For she'll take you by the hand and try to lead you into a room alone to talk. You must mind and not do that, else you'll bring bad luck on both of us.
So one Sunday, the white bear came and said now they could set off to see her father and mother. Well, off they started, she sitting on his back, and they went far and long. At last they came to a grand house, and there her brothers and sisters were running around out of doors at play. And everything was so pretty, 'twas a joy to see.
"This is where your father and mother live now," said the white bear. "But don't forget what I told you, else you'll make us both unlucky."
No, bless her, she did not forget. And when she'd reached the house, the white bear turned right around and left her. Then she went in to see her father and mother. And there was such joy, there was no end of it. None of them thought they could thank her enough for all she had done for them. Now they had everything they wished, as good could be. And they all wanted to know how she got on where she lived. Well, she said it was very good to live where she did. She had all she wished. What she said besides, I don't know. But I don't think any of them had the right end of the stick, or that they got much out of her. So in the afternoon, after dinner, all happened as the white bear had said. Her mother wanted to talk with her alone in her bedroom, but she minded what the white bear had said and wouldn't go upstairs. "Oh, what we have to talk about, we'll keep," she said, and put her mother off. But somehow or other, her mother got to her at last, and she had to tell her the whole story. So she told her how every night, when she'd gone to bed, a man came and lay down beside her as soon as she put out the light, and how she never saw him because he was always up and away before the morning dawned, and how she went around woeful and sorrowing, for she thought she should so like to see him, and how all day long she walked around alone, and how dull and dreary and lonesome it was. "My," said her mother, "it may well be a troll you slept with. But now I'll teach you how to set eyes on him. I'll give you a small candle, which you can carry home in your bosom. Just light that while he is asleep, but take care not to drop the tallow on him." Yes, she took the candle and hid it in her bosom, and as night drew on, the white bear came and fetched her away. When they had gone part of the way, the white bear asked if all hadn't happened as he had said. Well, she couldn't say it hadn't.
"Now mind," said he, "if you have listened to your mother's advice, you have brought bad luck on us both, and then all that has passed between us will be as nothing."
No, she said, she hadn't listened to her mother's advice. So when she reached home and had gone to bed, it was the old story over again. There came a man who lay down beside her. But at dead of night, when she heard he slept, she got up and struck a light, lit the candle, and let its light shine on him. And so she saw that he was the loveliest prince one ever set eyes on. And she fell so deep in love with him on the spot that she thought she couldn't live if she didn't give him a kiss there and then. And so she did. But as she kissed him, she dropped 3 hot drops of tallow on his shirt, and he woke up. "What have you done?" he cried. "Now you have made us both unlucky, for had you held out only this 1 year, I had been freed. For I have a stepmother who has bewitched me, so that I am a white bear by day and a man by night. But now all ties are snapped between us. Now I must set off from you to her. She lives in a castle which stands east of the sun and west of the moon. And there, too, is a princess with a nose 3 ells long, and she's the wife I must have now." She wept and took it ill. But there was no help for it. Go he must. Then she asked if she mightn't go with him. No, she mightn't. "Tell me the way, then," she said, "and I'll search you out. That, surely, I may get leave to do." Yes, she might do that, he said. But there was no way to the place. It lay east of the sun and west of the moon, and thither she'd never find her way. The next morning, when she woke up, both prince and castle were gone, and there she lay on a little green patch in the midst of a gloomy, thick forest, and by her side lay the same bundle of rags she had brought with her from her old home. So when she had rubbed the sleep out of her eyes and wept till she was tired, she set out on her way and walked many, many days till she came to a lofty crag. Under it sat an old hag who was playing with a gold apple, which she tossed around. The lassie asked her if she knew the way to the prince, who lived with his stepmother in the castle that lay east of the sun and west of the moon, and who was to marry the princess with a nose 3 ells long.
"How did you come to know about him?" asked the old hag. "Or maybe you are the lassie who ought to have had him."
Yes, she was.
So, it's you, is it?" said the old hag. "Well, all I know about him is that he lives in the castle that lies east of the sun and west of the moon, and thither you'll come, late or never. But still, you may have the loan of my horse, and on him you can ride to my next neighbor. Maybe she'll be able to tell you. And when you get there, just give the horse a switch under the left ear and beg him to be off home. And this gold apple you may take with you."
She got upon the horse and rode a long, long time, till she came to another crag, under which sat another old hag, with a gold carding comb. The lassie asked her if she knew the way to the castle that lay east of the sun and west of the moon, and she answered, like the first old hag, that she knew nothing about it, except it was east of the sun and west of the moon.
"And thither you'll come, late or never. But you shall have the loan of my horse to reach my next neighbor. Maybe she'll tell you all about it. And when you get there, just switch the horse under the left ear and beg him to be off home."
And this old hag gave her the golden carding comb. "It might be she'd find some use for it," she said. So the lassie got upon the horse and rode a far, far way and a weary time. And at last she came to another great crag, under which sat another old hag spinning with a gold spinning wheel. She asked her, too, if she knew the way to the prince and where the castle was that lay east of the sun and west of the moon. So it was the same thing over again.
"Maybe it's you who ought to have had the prince," said the old hag.
Yes, it was. But she didn't know the way any better than the other two. East of the sun and west of the moon it was, she knew. That was all.
"And thither you'll come, late or never. But I'll lend you my horse, and then I think you'd best ride to the east wind and ask him. Maybe he knows those parts and can blow you thither. But when you get to him, you need only give the horse a switch under the left ear and he'll trot home by himself."
And so, too, she gave her the gold spinning wheel.
"Maybe you'll find a use for it," said the old hag.
Then on she rode many, many days, a weary time, before she got to the East Wind's house. But at last she did reach it. And then she asked the East Wind if he could tell her the way to the prince who dwelt east of the sun and west of the moon. Yes, the East Wind had often heard tell of it, the prince and the castle. But he couldn't tell the way, for he'd never blown so far. "But if you wish, I'll go with you to my brother, the East Wind. Maybe he knows, for he's much stronger. If you will just get on my back, I'll carry you thither." Yes, she got on his back, and I should just think they went briskly along. When they got there, they went into the West Wind's house, and the East Wind said the lassie he had brought was the one who ought to have had the prince who lived in the castle east of the sun and west of the moon. And so he had come with her, and would be glad to know if the West Wind knew how to get to the castle. "Nay," said the West Wind, "that far I've never blown. But if you will, I'll go with you to our brother the South Wind, for he's much stronger than either of us. And he has flapped his wings far and wide. Maybe he'll tell you. You can get on my back, and I'll carry you to him." Yes, she got on his back, and so they traveled to the South Wind, and weren't so very long on the way either, I should think. When they got there, the West Wind asked him if he could tell her the way to the castle that lay east of the sun and west of the moon, for it was she who ought to have had the prince who lived there.
"You don't say so. That's her, is it?"
said the South Wind.
"Well, I've blustered around in most places in my time, but so far have I never blown. But if you wish, I'll take you to my brother, the North Wind. He is the oldest and strongest of all of us. And if he doesn't know where it is, you'll never find anyone in the world to tell you. You can get on my back,
and I'll carry you thither.
Yes, she got on his back, and away he went from his house at a fine rate. And this time, too, she wasn't long on her way. And when they got to the North Wind's house, he was so wild and cross. Cold puffs came from him a long way off.
Blast you both, what do you want?
He roared out, and struck them with an icy shiver. Well, said the South Wind, you needn't be so foul-mouthed, for here I am, your brother, the South Wind, and here is the lassie who ought to have had the prince, who dwells in the castle that lies east of the sun and west of the moon. And now she wants to ask you if you ever were there and can tell her the way, for she would be so glad to find him again.
Yes, I know well enough where it is, said the North Wind. Once in my life I blew an aspen leaf thither, but I was so tired I couldn't blow a puff for ever so many days after. But if you really wish to go, and aren't afraid to come along with me, I'll take you on my back and see if I can blow you there.
Yes, with all her heart, she must and would get there if it were possible in any way. And as for fear, however quickly he went, she wouldn't be afraid at all.
Very well, then, said the North Wind. But you must sleep here tonight, for we must have the whole day before us if we're to get there at all.
Early next morning, the North Wind woke her and puffed himself up and blew himself out and made himself so stout and big 'twas gruesome to look at him. And so off they went, high up through the air, as if they would never stop till they got to the world's end. Down here below, there was such a storm it threw down long tracts of forest and many houses. And when it swept over the great sea, ships foundered by hundreds. So they tore on and on. No one can believe how far they went. And still they went over the sea, and the North Wind got more and more weary, and so out of breath, he could scarce bring out a puff, and his wings drooped and drooped, till at last he sunk so low that the crests of the waves dashed over his heels.
Are you afraid? Said the North Wind.
No, she wasn't. But they weren't very far from land, and the North Wind had still enough strength left in him that he managed to throw her up on the shore under the windows of the castle, which lay east of the sun and west of the moon. But he was so weak and worn out, he had to stay there and rest many days before he could get home again.
Next morning, the lassie sat down under the castle window and began to play with the gold apple. And the first person she saw was the long nose who was to have the prince.
What do you want for your gold apple, you lassie?
Said the long nose and threw open the window.
It's not for sale, for gold or money, said the lassie.
If it's not for sale, for gold or money, what is it that you will sell it for? You may name your own price, said the princess.
Well, if I may get to the prince who lives here and be with him tonight, you shall have it, said the lassie whom the North Wind had brought.
Yes, she might. That could be done. So the princess got the gold apple. But when the lassie came up to the prince's bedroom at night, he was fast asleep. She called him and shook him, and between whiles she wept sore. But for all she could do, she couldn't wake him up. Next morning, as soon as day broke, the princess with the long nose came and drove her out again. So in the daytime, she sat down under the castle window and began to card with her golden carding comb. And the same thing happened. The princess asked what she wanted for it, and she said it wasn't for sale for gold or money. But if she might get leave to go up to the prince and be with him that night, the princess should have it. But when she went up, she found him fast asleep again, and for all she called and shook and wept and prayed, she couldn't get life into him. And as soon as the first gray peep of day came, the princess with the long nose came and chased her out again. So, in the daytime, the lassie sat down under the castle window and began to spin with her golden spinning wheel. And that, too, the princess with the long nose wanted to have. So she threw up the window and asked what she wanted for it. the lassie said, as she had twice before. It wasn't for sale for gold or money. But if she might go up to the prince, who was there, and be with him alone that night, she might have it. Yes, she might do that, and welcome. But now, you must know, there were some poor folk who had been carried off there. And as they sat in their room, which was next to the prince's, they had heard how a woman had been in there, and wept, and prayed, and called to him two nights running. And they told the prince. That evening, when the princess came with her sleepy drink, the prince made as if he drank, but threw it over his shoulder, for he could guess it was a sleepy drink. So when the lassie came in, she found the prince wide awake, and then she told him the whole story of how she had come there. Ah, said the prince, you've just come in the very nick of time, for tomorrow is to be our wedding day, but now I won't have the long nose, and you are the only woman in the world who can set me free. I'll beg the long nose to wash the shirt that has the three spots of tallow on it. She'll say yes, but that's a work no troll can do. And so I'll say that I won't have any other for my bride than the woman who can wash them out, and ask you to do it. So there was great joy and love between them all that night. The next day, when the wedding was to be, the prince said, first of all, I'd like to see what my bride is fit for. Yes, said the stepmother with all her heart. Well, said the prince, I've got a fine shirt which I'd like for my wedding shirt, but somehow or other it got three spots of tallow on it which I must have washed out. And I have sworn never to take any other bride than the woman who's able to do that. If she can't, she's not worth having. Well, that was no great thing, they said, so they agreed. And she, with the long nose, began to wash away as hard as she could. But the more she rubbed and scrubbed, the bigger the spots grew. Ah, said the old hag, her mother. You can't wash. Let me try. But she hadn't long taken the shirt in hand before it got far worse than ever. And with all her rubbing and wringing and scrubbing, the spots grew bigger and blacker and darker and uglier was the shirt. Then all the other trolls began to wash. But the longer it lasted, the blacker and uglier the shirt grew, till at last it was as black all over as if it had been up the chimney. Ah, said the prince, you're none of you worth a straw. You can't wash. Why, there outside sits a beggar lassie, and I'll be bound she knows how to wash better than all of you. Come in, lassie, he shouted. Well, in she came. Can you wash this shirt clean, lassie, you? Said he. I don't know, said she, but I think I can. And almost before she had taken it and dipped it in the water, it was as white as driven snow, and whiter still. Yes, you are the lassie for me, said the prince. At that, the old hag flew into such a rage, she burst on the spot, and the princess with the long nose after her, and the whole pack of trolls after her. At least I've never heard a word about them since. As for the prince and the lassie, they set free all the poor folk who'd been carried off and shut up there, and they took with them all the silver and gold and flitted away as far as they could from the castle that lay east of the sun and west of the moon. What do we notice about this story? The story has a pattern that I recognize from many other stories. Not just myths and fairy tales, but also movies, in which a young hero has to leave home to go on a quest to learn something necessary to a successful life as an adult. It's a pattern we see over and over again. In fact, it's so famous it has a name. They call it the hero's journey. We find this pattern in Gilgamesh, a story from 4,000 years ago. We find it again in Jack and the Beanstalk, even in the story of Luke Skywalker in the early Star Wars movies. Many of these hero's journey stories or about a male hero, a boy who goes on a quest. Often he must rescue a princess. Part of what I enjoy so much about this story is that the person who has the adventure is a girl. She's the one who shows courage, who uses her brains and her skills to rescue a prince who's locked away in a castle. I enjoyed seeing a brave heroine as our leading character. In addition, I noticed the illustrations in this book. I think they're excellent, and they bring the drama of the story to life. When I first saw this one from late in the story, it reminded me of a famous painting called The Kiss that was painted by the Austrian artist Gustav Klimt. Do you see the similarities? Klimt painted The Kiss in 1908, while this book was published 83 years later in 1991. Come to think of it, the story we read today, East of the Sun and West of the Moon, reminds me of another fairy tale, Beauty and the Beast. It turns out, both of those fairy tales were inspired by another famous story called Cupid and Psyche, which was written almost 2,000 years ago. It's amazing how stories and paintings from so long ago can still give ideas to artists today. It's almost like artists get to have a conversation with creative people who lived thousands of years in the past. Thank you so much for joining me for Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. Until next time, discover the wonder in a book. Pick one up. Take a look.
If you enjoyed this Read Aloud with Mr. Paul, please like, subscribe, and share this video with your friends. Thanks again.